Great Gatsby, page 17, the very last line. You make me feel uncivilized, Daisy, I confessed, on my second glass of quirky but rather impressive claret. Can't you talk about crops or something? I meant nothing in particular by this remark, but it was taken up in an unexpected way. Civilization's going to pieces, broke out Tom violently. I've gotten to be a terrible pessimist about things. Have you read The Rise of the Colored Empires? By this man, Godard? Why, no, I answered, rather surprised by this tone. By his tone. Well, it's a fine book, and everybody ought to read it. The idea is, if we don't look out, the white race will be utterly submerged. It's all scientific stuff. It's been proved. Tom's getting very profound, said Daisy, with an expression of unthoughtful sadness. He reads deep books with long words in them. What was the word? Well, these books are all scientific, insisted Tom, glancing at her impatiently. This fellow has worked out the whole thing. It's up to us, or the dominant race, to watch out, or these other races will have control of things. We've got to beat them down, whispered Daisy, winking ferociously toward the fervent sun. You ought to live in California, began Miss Baker. But Tom interrupted her by shifting heavily in his chair. This idea is that we're Nordics. I am, and you are, and you are, and after an infinitesimal hesitation, he inclined Daisy with a slight nod. She winked at me again. And we've produced all the things that go to make civilization. Oh, science and art and all that, do you see? There was something pathetic in his concentration, as if his complacency, more acute than of old, was not enough to him anymore. When almost immediately the phone rang inside and the butler left the porch, Daisy seized upon the momentary interruption and leaned towards me. I'll tell you a family secret, she whispered enthusiastically. It's about the butler's nose. Do you want to hear about the butler's nose? That's why I came over tonight. Well, he wasn't always a butler. He used to be the silver polisher for some people in New York. They had a silver service for 200 people. He had to polish it from morning till night until it finally began to affect his nose. Things went from bad to worse, suggested Miss Baker. Yes, things went from bad to worse, until finally he had to give up his position. For a moment, the last sunshine fell with romantic affection upon her glowing face. Her voice compelled me forward breathlessly as I listened. Then the glow faded, each light deserting her with lingering regret, like children leaving a pleasant street at dusk. The butler came back and murmured something close to Tom's ear, whereupon Tom frowned, pushed back his chair, and without a word went inside. As if his absence quickened something within her, Daisy leaned forward again, her voice glowing and singing. I'd love to see you at my table, Nick. You remind me of a rose, an absolute rose, doesn't he? She turned to Miss Baker for confirmation. An absolute rose? This was untrue. I am not faintly like a rose. She was only extemporizing, but a stirring warmth flowed from her, as if her heart was trying to come out to you, concealed in one of those breathless, thrilling words. Then suddenly, she threw her napkin on the table and excused herself and went into the house. Miss Baker and I exchanged a short glance consciously, devoid of meaning. I was about to speak when she sat up alertly and said, shh, in a warning voice. A subdued, impassioned murmur was audible in a room beyond. And Miss Baker leaned forward unashamed, trying to hear. The murmur trembled on the verge of coherence, sank down, mounted excitedly, and then ceased altogether. "This Mr. Gatsby you spoke of is my neighbor," I began. "Don't talk. I want to hear what happens." "Is something happening?" I inquired innocently. "You mean to say you don't know?" said Miss Baker. Honestly surprised. "I thought everybody knew." "I don't." "Why?" she said hesitantly. "Tom's got some woman in New York." "Got some woman?" I repeated blankly. Miss Baker nodded. "She might have the decency not to telephone him at dinner time, don't you think?" Almost before I had grasped her meaning, there was the flutter of a dress at the crunch of leather boots. Leather boots. And Tom and Daisy were back at the table. "It couldn't be helped," cried Daisy with tense gaiety. She sat down, glanced searchingly at Miss Baker, and then at me, and continued. "I looked outdoors for a minute, and it's very romantic outdoors. There is a bird on the lawn that I think must be Nightingale come over. Must be a Nightingale come over on the Cunard White Star Line. He's singing away," her voice sang. "It's romantic, isn't it, Tom?" "Very romantic," he said, and then miserably to me, "If it's light enough after dinner, I want to take you down to the stables." The telephone rang inside, startlingly, and as Daisy took her head decisively at Tom, the subject of the stables, in fact all subjects, vanished into air. Among the broken fragments of the last 5 minutes at table, I remember the candles being lit again, pointlessly, and I was conscious of wanting to look squarely at everyone, and yet to avoid all eyes. I couldn't guess what Daisy and Tom were thinking, but I doubt if even Miss Baker, who seemed to have mastered a certain hardy skepticism, was able utterly to put his fifth guest's shrill metallic urgency out of mind. To a certain temperament, the situation might have seemed intriguing. My own instinct was to telephone immediately for the police. The horses, needless to say, were not mentioned again. Tom and Miss Baker, with several feet of twilight between them, strolled back into the library as if to a vigil beside a perfectly tangible body, while trying to look pleasantly interested and a little deaf. I followed Daisy around a chain of connecting verandas to the porch in front. In its deep gloom, we sat down side by side on a wicker that's very funny, this word. S-E-T-T-E-E. I wonder if it's SETI or SETI. It's probably what it is. A type of seat made out of wicker. Very fashionable in those days. Daisy took her face in her hands as if feeling its lovely shape, and her eyes moved gradually out into the velvet dusk. I saw that turbulent emotions possessed her, and I asked what I thought. So I asked what I thought would be some sedative questions, or sedative questions, about her little girl. "We don't know each other very well, Nick," she said suddenly. "Even if we are cousins, you didn't come to my wedding." I wasn't back from the war." "That's true," she hesitated. "Well, I've had a very bad time, Nick, and I'm pretty cynical about everything." Evidently, she had reason to be. I waited, but she didn't say any more. And after a moment, I returned rather feebly to the subject of her daughter. "I suppose she talks and eats and everything." "Oh yes," she looked at me absently. "Listen, Nick, Let me tell you what I said when she was born. Would you like to hear? Very much. Okay, so I tried something different this time. I just read through a very long segment. And now I'm just going to discuss the bits that I find worth discussing. Well, at the very beginning of page 18, if you have this edition here, we see that Tom is very racist. And I know nowadays you can't really say anything about racism without being attacked, either by people who don't want to acknowledge that racism exists or by people who are racist themselves that want to defend their positions. But I'm giving a point of view from the book, from Tom's perspective. Tom is a character in the book, and his perspective is that the white race is superior because they created things. They invented, created, developed what we know to be civilization. The reason why I'm saying that this is a racist point of view is that one can argue, what is civilization? Do the tribes in Africa, where they took the slaves from, do they not have a civilization because they don't have the same use for technology that we do? How about the indigenous peoples, such as the indigenous Brazilians, Native Americans, all over the world, the Maoris, the Aboriginals, were they not civilized just because they didn't have technology, some sort of technology? What makes a race superior to another? So those are just points of view. But from the point of view of this character that we're discussing right now, Tom, he says a lot of racist things that I'm going to go back and tell you. He mentions a book, The Rise of the Colored Empires. And when he mentions that book, he says it's a fine book and everybody ought to read it. The idea is, if we don't look out, the white race will be utterly submerged. Submerged. That's a word that encompasses what he's trying to say here. Although many may disagree with me when I say the character is expressing racist points of view, he brings up race as if one race had to be superior or one race had to be on top of everything. So it's quite interesting to me that this topic was already brought out when this book was written. Nowadays we have what is called cancel culture, where a person can't really express their point of view without being bombarded with a million attacks if the majority doesn't agree with them. But what we have here is a character expressing racist views, and one might argue, hey, perhaps those were the views of the writer. Perhaps F. Scott Fitzgerald was racist. Well, I'm not going to go that far. When we discuss authors that have passed away, we can't really talk about how they think without evidence. So unless I find evidence that he was racist somewhere, I'm not going to accuse F. Scott Fitzgerald of being a racist. But the topic of racism comes up in this chapter. We also see that Gatsby is brought up again. We also find out that one of the characters has a baby girl. And when asked about the baby girl, this is at the bottom of page 21, Nick asks Daisy about her little girl. We don't see this in the dialogue itself. It just says, we indirectly hear about it, or rather, we read about it on this line here. I returned rather feebly to the subject of her daughter. We only see that she answers. I suppose she talks and eats and everything. So I'm not sure whether this has something to do with the fact that she's not utterly excited about her little girl. Or perhaps this is a sarcastic remark. We have no way of knowing. We can just draw our own conclusions about that. And this brings this video to a close. I'm in the library today, and I came in a little bit later than I normally come in here. And yeah, it's gonna get noisy in here, I think.